We have been talking about worship, and we've been reading from the book of John, where Jesus must needs go through Samaria, and because he knew he had an encounter with this lady, and she becomes a famous Bible person for years to see. She's a lady not living her life where she should. She's living in sin. We're sometimes certainly in sin. And Jesus goes up to her, and she can tell right out of the gate there's something special about him. And they have conversation, and, you know, she's a Samaritan lady. And she starts talking about worshiping on a mountain. And she says, you know, that our fathers say that this is where we're supposed to worship. You know, if we know biblical history, and I'm going to get to this one day, we'll get to it in the worship series. But the reason they have a different place to worship is because folks couldn't get along. And the Samaritans weren't allowed to help rebuild the temple, and they found their own place to worship. And so, you know, it's just amazing how we have so many different things going on at so many different places, so many churches, so many denominations. So many times people come and assemble in the name of God through their Son, Jesus Christ. That's a whole nother story. But here, Jesus comes and he talks to her. And you know, if you've been coming, what's said next. And if you don't, we're going to read it together. So read with me John chapter 4, as Jesus is now in conversation with her. She says, starting in verse number 20, "Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where we ought to worship." Jesus says unto her, "Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what, for we know not what we worship, for salvation," we know what we worship, "for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth." He says, true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And then he goes on, as he says in the next verse here, "For the Father seeketh such to worship him." It's what God desires. He desires us to worship him in truth and in spirit. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Let us pray. God, we just come to you now because you are a great God. You're everything. God, you're our creator, our sustainer of life. We have breath today because you have breathed it into us. You created us from dust. And God, these earthly bodies, if Jesus doesn't come back first, we'll go back to dust. But God, you have given us a soul and a spirit aligned with you that will be with you forever. God, as we open up your word today and we speak of worship, may we understand that this very thing is what your book tells us we shall do for eternity, is to be in your presence and to worship you. God, I just thank you so much for your patience, your long-suffering towards myself and each one of us. God, I thank you for your grace, the way you have organized that even us lost sinners, broken in every way, can call upon you, the mighty Creator, the God, because you've made a way through your Son, Jesus, that his death has atoned for our sins. God, you make it so simple that if we just believe in your Son and what you've done, we shall have salvation and be with you. God, I just ask you, as you speak to us today, God, may it be totally you. God, I am your messenger, and I want to align with what you want. And I just ask you to speak through me, God. May it be less of me and more of you. God, for the distraction that tries to take our minds somewhere else, God, may we intently focus and listen to you and your Spirit today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, I told Dwayne during communion, I said, I'm just about to bust open. I am ready to just talk about the Lord today. Last week, we talked, or a couple of weeks ago as we started this, we talked about that there's faith, and then immediately following faith, we're seeing the example in Scripture that we're to be in worship with Him. After that worship comes the ministry, those other things that we do, but immediately upon our connection with the Father, there is worship. We went over 1 Peter chapter 1 and chapter 2, how chapter 1 talks about salvation. Immediately in chapter 2, it talks about that worship of the Father. Romans chapter 12, the same thing. But I want us to go back today, and I'm going to throw out the 5 points we talked about last week, and then we're going to go into Exodus chapter 32. So if you want to go ahead and be turning your Bibles there in Exodus chapter 32. But we talked about worship as we looked at David and Mary, two different examples, an Old Testament and a New Testament example last week, and we saw the similarities of true worship with each one of them. One, they gave God their very best. It was nothing less than their best. Secondly, they humbled themselves. It was not about them at all. They took themselves out of the picture. They humbled themselves to come to God. There was an understanding in both cases that when you truly give yourself to God, somebody is going to scorn you. Somebody's going to judge what it is you're doing in your worship. Number four, their worship was centered on God, not something else. God was the center. And lastly, they were always seeking to go deeper. And for that, we're allowed. Go with me to Exodus chapter 32 as we look in Scripture today. And I want us to see in this first part some false worship. In Exodus chapter 32, what has happened here is Moses has led Israel out of the promised land, out of bondage, and they're headed to the promised land. He's up on Mount Sinai. And he's in a relationship with God. Relationship, you've heard me say that over and over. God doesn't want just us to go through a process. He wants a relationship. Relationship has with it fellowship. And so here's Moses in his relationship with God, and they're getting to talk. That's fellowship. And so they're up there talking, and Lord, what's everybody else doing? Even Aaron is back with them. Some of you biblically, you understand what's happening, that these people, they're sitting there and they're like, well, wait a minute. You know, we got to do something. Moses is delayed. He's waiting, buddy. He's not coming down. We got to do something. And we know the story. Read along with me just a few verses, chapter 32 of Exodus. They go to Aaron in verse 1, and they say, hey, we got to have a God to worship. Moses ain't coming down. Verse 2, it says this, and Aaron said unto them, break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. I want you to think about that. He says, take the very jewelry that your family has. Well, real quickly, just so you understand, this jewelry that they have, they were slaves. Egypt literally threw it at them as they were telling them to please leave. That's how God turns things around. And so God had a purpose for every bit of blessing that He gave them. And they've got it in their ears, and they're wearing it around their neck, and they've got it on their hands, gold and silver and precious jewels, all that God gave them. They had nothing. God gave it to them. And so they go to Aaron, and he says, hey, take these things of value, because when we worship, it's supposed to be about the very best. And he takes them and he throws them all in a big pot, and he melts them down, and he makes a calf. It says in verse 6, and they rose up early on the morning and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. Now, I want you to understand something here. Aaron's supposed to be Moses' right-hand man, but he has allowed this false worship. What I want you to see, we are relational beings made to worship. God created us to worship Him. It's not something you learn. God created you with a desire to be in a relationship with Him, to worship Him. He's made us that way. And if we don't worship God, we shall worship something. They turn their attention. We got to have something. And so we see that verse 6, they rose up early in the morrow and they offered burnt offerings. Now, what I want you to see about this offering, there's so much that is in this. Burnt offerings are the sin offerings. Burnt offerings were made by God to say, this is how your sin shall be atoned. There's all kinds of other offerings But the burnt offering is the special offering. It's the Jesus to us. And notice the very first thing they do to a God they pulled out of their ear and off of their neck and physically saw man form in front of them. They worshiped. Man, we think, how could they be so dumb? I mean, that's the first thing that comes in my mind. Let's go a little bit further. God sees what's going on. He says this to Moses in verse 10, "Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and will make of thee a great nation." God and Moses up there talking. God says, "Moses, stop this wonderful time we're having together. I'm getting ready to wipe out your people." To tell you about the relationship and the fellowship Moses and God has, I want to show you something. If you'll go with me, they have conversation. But in verse 13, Moses says this to God. He says, "God, remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants, to whom thou sworest by thine own self, and said unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of will I give unto your seed, and they shall inherit it forever." You know what Moses was able to do? Because he knew God. Because he had relationship with God. Because he fellowships with God. He knew God's heart, and he knew that through God's Word. He was able to say, "God, you've said this." Not that God needed correcting, but I can tell you this, for me and my wife, we're getting ready to celebrate 24 years of marriage. That's a tough woman, y'all. We learn something new about each other every day. And I know so many things about her because we have spent time together. I study for Melody. I study Melody. I feel sorry for her all the time for putting up with me. But there's relationship. It has fellowship, talking. We know about each other, the intricate details of each other, and still, with all of that, there's something new revealed every day. Moses knew God because of God's Word, and God does not change. And so for that, he was able to speak to God in relationship and fellowship. And God says, "You're right, I'm not going to do that." Because God does not change His mind. What God says is eternal. So Moses leaves, and I can just imagine, I've been put in this situation a few times before. He leaves up there with God, and he's headed down the mountain. And all the way down, he is thinking, "Man, this people I got messed up with, they done got me in trouble again. Maybe I ought to let God just wipe them all out." He comes down, he sees them dancing and worshiping to this false idol. He throws the very tablets that the Ten Commandments are written on. They're broken. You know the story that goes into play. He says in verse 19, "And it came to pass as soon as he came nigh unto the camp that he saw the calf and the dancing. Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand, and he brake them beneath the mount." Verse 20, "And he took the calf which they had made, and he burned it in the fire, and ground it to powder, and strawed it upon the water, and made the children of Israel to drink it." A few things I want you to see, and we've got to move on for time. First of all, we think, how could they have been so dumb? They just took their stuff and they made a calf right then. How could they think that was God? They took the very blessings God had given them. God had given them those blessings, and they turned it into an idol. We say we would never do that. But many times in this life, we've taken the very blessings of God and we've turned them into idols. It may not be as pretty as a gold calf in front of us, but there are all kinds of things that we begin to worship that is not God. False worship. What I want you to understand about that, there's a lesson here. Verse 20 says, "He took it, he ground it to powder, he threw it in the water, he made the children to drink of it." We shall taste of our sin. Did you get that? God tells us to exercise our senses in His Word, that we need to taste of the Word of God, for it is good. And when we seek something that is not of God, we're still going to taste it, and it's going to leave a bad taste in our mouth. Moving on, we see some things that happen. Verse 30, "And it came to pass on the morrow, and Moses said unto the people, You've sinned a great sin now, and I go up unto the Lord. Preadventure, I shall make atonement for sin." Moses still steps on their behalf. He goes up and speaks to the Lord. This is what he says in verse 32, "Yet now if thou wilt forgive their sin." Moses standing before God saying, "Forgive their sin. Blot me, I pray thee, out of the book which thou hast written." But you know what God says? He says, "Moses, you are not good enough to be their sacrifice. There's only one who was ever good enough to be an eternal sacrifice for us, and that is Jesus Christ. He says this in verse 33, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book." God says in verse 35, "And the Lord plagued the people because they made the calf which Aaron made." Something I want you to see, there's false worship. Their center was not on God. And they had to deal with that because of it. And then there are what I call the repercussions of false worship. Two things that I want you to get, if nothing else, out of today. Notice in verse 33, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Depart and go up hence, thou and thy people, which thou hast brought out of the land of Egypt, to the land which I swear unto Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." This is all what he's already said. Hey, these people are going to go to this promised land, the land of milk and honey. But notice what it says in the last verse. "Unto thy seed will I give it." We that understand Scripture know most of that generation never got to see the promised land, because they never entered into God's rest. They walked up beside it, but they didn't have enough faith to enter it. So they kept a life of wandering. There's a message there for many of us today, that our faith may not be where it needs to be, where we want to enter into God's rest and we get right close to it, but then we turn and we lack the faith to enter into the rest of God. We'll come back to that. He says, "Unto thy seed will I give it." What I want you to see, number one, is false worship is God will remove His blessing in every way. When we worship something other than the Creator, God will remove His blessing. The second thing I want you to see, look with me, verse 3, chapter 33, verse 3. He says, "Unto a land flowing with milk and honey, for I will not go into the midst of thee, for thou art a stiff-necked people, lest I consume thee in the way." What verse 2 says is, "I will now send an angel to drive others out." You're still going to go? I'm going to send an angel. Up until this point, God led them where they were going. But now something different happens. God says, "I can't go in the middle of them, because if I do, I will consume them." The second thing that happens when we worship the wrong thing, or we have unaccepted worship, first thing is we lose God's blessing. The second thing is we lose the very presence of God. We see here that the people, verse 4, they mourned. No man put on his ornaments. Do you see the conviction? They changed. They took that stuff away. They said, "No way. We don't want that. It's leading to this now." Verse 10, the people, Moses had to take now the tent where God would meet with them out of the camp. God would no longer go in the middle of the camp. It had to be outside, and the people weren't allowed to go there. And so there goes Moses out, and the people would watch Moses go into the tent. They couldn't come around, and God would ascend through a cloud. They would see physically the cloud upon the tent, and they knew the presence of God. And notice what it says they did in verse 10, "And the people rose up, and they worshiped every man in his tent." You see, when you see the presence of God, you have to worship. I want to look at Moses' example. Start with me in verse 12. "Moses said unto the Lord, See, thou sayest unto me, Bring up this people, for thou hast let me know whom thou wilt send with me." A couple of things I want you to see. Moses, who's in relationship, and within relationship, he's in with fellowship with God. He knows God's heart. God has told him. He says, "This is what you're to do. You're to carry this people." He's just experienced all this that's going on, but Moses knows God still called him to a task. And so he goes to God and he says, "Hey God, I know you still want me to go, but who is it you want me to carry with you?" You see that communication? That's what he's asking in this verse. He says, "And thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me, yet thou hast said, I know thy name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight." Moses goes before God. He says, "God, you've told me I found grace in your sight. I know you've called me to a task. Would you reveal more to me?" Notice what is said next, verse 13. Moses says, "Now therefore I pray thee." They're talking just as you and I talk. That's prayer to God. He says, "Now therefore I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight." Notice how many times that is said. "If I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee and I may find grace in thy sight. And consider that this nation is thy people." Moses says over and over, "God, you've told me I have found grace in your sight. You've called me to a task. Would you show me, God, what it is that I need to do next?" God says this in verse 14. He says, "My presence shall go with thee." God's presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. Did you get that? Moses says, "If your grace is with me, show me what it is you want me to do." God says, "My presence shall go with you." Notice what happens as we go a little bit further. He says, "And my presence is going to do what? It's going to bring you that rest." There is nothing like rest in God. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about, and some of you long for it, but it's real, and there's nothing that can replace the rest of God. He goes on. He says, "And he said unto him, If thou presence go not with me, carry us not up." You know what he says? Moses is saying, "Hey, God, if you're not going to go with us, we ain't going anywhere. We're going to sit right where we are." He goes on to say, verse 16, "For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight?" This is a question. Moses is asking God, "How is it going to be known that we have found grace in your sight?" Another question to his answer, "Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated." We're to be holy. God's people are to be different than this world. And notice what happens in the next verse. "And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name." What I want you to see, Moses says, "How are we going to know we found grace in your sight? It's going to be because of your presence with us, God. That's how we're going to know we found grace in your sight." And God said, "It shall be. You will know you have found the grace of God in the presence of God." Then a very intimate moment happens in the very next verse. Moses says, "I beseech thee, show me thy glory." You know what Moses is asking for? I mean, he's talking to God, but he doesn't get to see God. He says, "God, please show me more of you." Moses, who's in the right relationship and fellowship with God, is at this intimate moment with God where he says, "Show me your glory." God's answer, as we look a little bit further, says, starting in verse 19, "And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I'll be gracious, and will show mercy to whom I show mercy." Listen to what God says next. "And he said, Thou cannot see my face, for there shall no man see me and live." God's greatness is so good that if he were in his completeness in front of us right now, we would be consumed up to dust. But he says, "Moses, you're in the right relationship with me. You're in fellowship with me. So I'm going to show you more because you asked." And notice how God does that in these next verses. He says in verse 21, "And the Lord said, Behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. And it shall come to pass when my glory passeth by that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face you can't see." We get the image of Moses being put in a hole in a rock, and God puts his hand up so he doesn't fully consume him as he walks by. His glory is his presence. But he does allow Moses to see something that he's never seen before. You see, worship goes deeper. Chapter 34, verses 1 through 7, talk about the next day that here comes Moses. He's put in the rock. This happens. New tablets are made. And immediately when God passes by Moses, look at verse 8. "And Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth, and he worshiped." Immediately he worshiped. You know, we changed and we sung a hymn, hymn number 243. And I just want to carry you there for just a second. Moses, Old Testament, Jesus has not come. He is able to see God. We see all kinds of precursors, prophecy of the Messiah coming, a way that our sins can be forgiven, where we can be in the presence of God. It is only through Jesus Christ. There is no other way to God the Father but Jesus Christ. And this song brings out the truth of Scripture that we today are hid in Christ, who is our rock. You see, just as Moses was put in the cleft of the rock, we are hidden in Jesus, which is the rock. And listen to the words of this Psalm 243. The first stanza says, "Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. I am to be hidden in Jesus Christ. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flowed." If you don't understand that, that's Jesus on the cross as a spear goes into his side, and it plainly tells us that he has blood and water that gushes out, and that is where the forgiveness of our sin comes from Jesus' blood given on the cross. It goes on, "Be of sin the double cure." What Jesus did is a double cure for our sin. "Save me from sin's guilt and power." Verse 2. "Not the labors of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands." We cannot do enough good on our own. "Could my zeal," what I do, how good I am, no respite, no. "Could my tears forever flow?" We can cry all day long if we don't have Jesus. It doesn't matter. "For all for sin could not atone. Thou, Jesus, must save, and thou alone." Third stanza, "Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling." I literally picture just at the foot of the cross, hanging on to it with all of my might. "Naked come to thee for dress." We are totally naked in God's eyes. He sees us completely as we are. "Helpless look to thee for grace." Did you get that? It is only by God's grace. "Foul, I to the fountain fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, with my eyes shall close in death. When I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne." We will all see God on his judgment throne. "Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee." You know, some of you might think, well, that's a great hymnal. It's got a good message to us, but you're preaching a hymnal. Now, I just ask you to turn with me real quick to the book of Colossians. In Colossians chapter 3, I'm just going to read a few verses. It says this, "If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on the things above, not on things of the earth, for you're dead, your life is hid with Christ in God." He is our rock. All through the New Testament, Jesus is the cornerstone. He is our rock. He is the way that we're in a cleft of a rock, and through Him, God will show us more. I've had so much happen personally over the last days, weeks, in a relationship with the Lord. And guys, I just have to tell you, I've spoken to our Wednesday night group some, but I just got to shout it from the rooftops. We're hearing messages of worship of God. Let me just ask a couple of questions about worship and about church altogether. Number one, do you believe God has the ability to do anything, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out demons, to do anything that Scripture says God can do? Do we think He can do that? Do you believe in the power of prayer yourself? People know this is a praying church. Do you believe in the power of prayer? Do you believe there's something good about us doing this prayer list and us praying for individuals, laying hands on them at some times and praying for people? Do you believe that God does things because His people request? Do you believe that? If you believe that, raise your hand that you believe in the power of God. All right? I mean nothing pointing about this. How many of us have needed God for something? Raise your hand if that's you. Okay? Put your hand down. So we are saying we believe in God who can do everything, and that we believe that God will answer prayers to the point we're willing to put people on a prayer list. But either we think we can handle it on our own, or we think despite our continuing to follow God that it's okay that we don't come to His prayer meetings, that I can pray once a week and God's just going to take care of things if I get my 5-second prayer in before I'm telling you, this is not guilt. It's not why I'm going here. I want to show you something. I want to show you how we live in this life. And Buddy couldn't have hit it any better as he went to communion meditation of wait and slow down and look around and see God working. Let me ask you something else. If you would, go with me. 1 Corinthians, I don't know if you got it or not, Shannon. You'll get it. I know you will. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm not going to go over spiritual gifts. That's still later. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, look what the first three verses say. Paul says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, he's talking to the church at Corinth. Concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would that you not be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led. They were all worshiping something false. They didn't know they were worshiping something false, but they were all worshiping something false. They weren't coming to God. But God, in His intimate design, has put the church with such a purpose. The very church, not the building, but the people of the church. We are the body of Christ. This chapter says that. Do you believe that? What God's Word says? Do you believe from His Word and what it says in here, that when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, that you are gifted in some gift that it says in Scripture? Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Ephesians 4. You are gifted in some spiritual gift when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Well, why are we settling for coming and not expecting to meet God in the very worship service that we come in? Why are we not expecting that God's going to hear our prayers when we call upon Him? But you say you do, but why don't we do more of it? This is not a guilt trip, but I want you to understand this. I cannot continue moving in the days of my life without understanding that God's Word is true in every way and that God will be present in the believers' lives. And people are looking for something in this world. They're lost, they're hurting, and we say, come to church, it's all going to be better. And then they come and it's no better. Why? Because we're no different because we're not allowing the Holy Spirit to lead our lives. Now, some of you, I may not be speaking to you, but I am saying that in this life today, in the fruits we see all around, this is not a judgment. Please understand, I'm not talking down, I'm talking up. God has laid such a burden on my heart, I know it. What people in this world need when they come into church is to see we have found grace in the sight of God. Moses was told, you shall know that you have found grace in the sight of God because my presence will go with you. You see, there's something different in the church. God has used the individuals for a mighty way, and it's the same church that we see in the book that is to be today. We could have all kinds of doctrinal statements and disagreements. I don't care about any of that right now. What I want you to understand that God has not changed. He is the same God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And so when it comes to worship, God our Creator, if you believe God will answer prayers and He can, then let's pray to Him. And let's do it with a heart fervent that says, God, You are the center of my worship. You are my absolute all. Let me come to You with my very best, God. And I don't care who scorns me for coming to You because You are the center of my throne. You see, that's what God wants. He wants worshipers that will come to Him seeking Him in spirit and truth, spiritual truth. Guys, we can't do it if we don't know His Word. I'm just going to tell you, you cannot seek God in truth if you don't know what His Word is. And I know many of you know God's Word. You have looked at God's Word. You study in many ways, Sunday schools, in your own time. I get that. But we've got to do more of God's Word. But God's Word is not enough. He does not say, those that seek me just in my Word. He says, if you're going to worship me in spirit and in truth. We have to allow His Holy Spirit to come in as well. Romans chapter 12, 1. God says, or Paul says this, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies, the very best you have, as living sacrifice. Everything I've got is yours, God. With an expectation, I know you're real. People want to see real. They need real. Because false doesn't heal their families. False doesn't heal the sick. False doesn't give us a leading of what God has asked us to do in our lives. People are longing to worship real. And God is the only thing that is. It says, unto God, which is your reasonable service. That word service means worship. It is our reasonable worship. I'm going to close us in prayer. Would you stand with me? God, thank you for your word and your Holy Spirit. And I thank you for these men and women present today. Those listening abroad, God, only you know what you're doing in the heart of each individual. God, I first of all thank you for that grace. As Moses said, if I have found grace in your sight, God, I ask the same thing. God, if I have found grace in your sight, God, just be with me. I want you to be with me every day. God, I ask you to be with this congregation every day. And God, I also ask, just as Moses did, God, if we found grace in your sight, would you reveal us just the next step, what it is in every step of our life, of the ministry, of whatever it is we're to do, God, would you just show it to us? Would you reveal it to us, God, because I know you're real. God, you have revealed yourself. God, you're so good. And when I think back and I listen to Paul's example of 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and Romans 12 and Ephesians 4 of what the church is, God, that there is this gifting coming in, that some are given the gift of knowledge, some of wisdom, some of faith. There's all this gifting that comes in, God, so many gifts, God, that there is the gift of healing, that there's all of these things, God, that you allow to work in your church and you put the church in action. God, I don't want to be a part of a dead church. Nobody here wants to be in a dead church. This church is not dead and shall not be. God, we want to be a part of you. God, forgive us where we fall short. Hide us in the cleft of the rock, God, but show us more of your glory. And God, would you just put a fire under each individual here today that's open to understanding, God, there really is so much more than we know. There's so much more of you that you'll just reveal to us in Scripture. God, there's so much that just in relationship and fellowship with you, God, that you'll show us and you'll lead us. And God, your presence will be with us and your blessing will be upon what we do. God, that's the church that we want to be. God, I just ask you to be with us. God, we love you and we praise you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Before you...